My very special guest is Stephen from Team Euphoric. Steve, good to have you.
Good to be with you.
Awesome. All right, so just for anyone who hasn't heard of you before, doesn't know where to find you and all of that sort of stuff, give us the brief rundown. Who is Stephen? Who is Team Euphoric? Where do we find you?
Okay, so in terms of where to find me, Team Euphoric across the board, TeamEuphoric.com, Team Euphoric Health and Performance on YouTube, Team Euphoric on Instagram, Team Euphoric on Twitter, but I'm banned on Twitter, so you're not really going to be able to see anything on there. Mm-hmm. And then in terms of myself, I have been a coach for, it'll be 18 years in August. I started in 2004, and it was really kind of part-time hobby to make a little bit of money through university. Then 2009, I decided to dedicate all of my effort and energy into coaching, nutrition, all that type of stuff. And that also happened to coincide with me being diagnosed with ulcerative colitis. So 2009, at the tail end, I started getting a little bit of blood in my stool. Then 2010, it got really, really bad. Went to the gastroenterologist in March, was diagnosed with ulcerative colitis. And that also happened to be around the same time that I discovered people like Paul Check and Charles Poliquin. So when I discovered Paul Check and Charles Poliquin, that's when I really started doing paleo and keto diet, because they endorsed the paleo diet. And I just coincidentally happened to do keto diet without even realizing what the keto diet was. I just knew that for me personally, I responded really well to high fat. So I was doing keto, but I never heard of it until about a year or two later. And then in 2015, or sorry, 2013, January 2013, I did the carnivore diet. And once again, I had no idea that I was doing it. It was just a complete fluke. I was just using my reasoning from my past experience with the paleo diet of what would our ancestors have done had they been around. And they would have looked for the most nutrient-dense and energy-dense foods, and that would have been meat, because if you're going to stumble across broccoli in the wild, you're not going to get much energy from it, and it's going to taste like shit if you don't put anything on it. So I figured, let me just see what's going to happen if I just do meat and nothing else. So I did that January and February of 2013, and at the time, an organic grocery store had just opened up by my house. So they had a sale on rotisserie chickens. I ended up having a whole rotisserie chicken every single day, and that's all I ate for 2 months. Was the best I had felt since being diagnosed with ulcerative colitis. After the 2 months was over, I started incorporating a little bit more vegetables, and I noticed that my digestion would always get a little bit sluggish around the wintertime. So in 2015, I decided to experiment with the vegan diet, and I did a 3-month experiment, and I told myself, I don't care what happens, for 3 months, I'm going to stick to it religiously. So I did that for 3 months. The first 2 weeks were absolutely great. My digestion was feeling amazing. After 2 weeks, I noticed that certain grains would really aggravate my GI, my gastrointestinal symptoms. So I noticed that Teffan amaranth, when I ate it, within 5 minutes, I'd be running to the washroom and it would just be diarrhea and it would be in the toilet. So I eliminated those, and for a week, everything was okay. And then other grains started to trigger my symptoms. So I noticed the quinoa was no longer a good grain for me. So I cut that out, was good for a week. And then that kind of happened throughout the entire 3 months, where at the end of the 3 months, the only three grains that I really could tolerate without causing me extreme distress were millet, buckwheat, and rice. So after the 3 months were over, I decided to go back on carnivore. Still hadn't heard of the carnivore diet, but I just remember how amazing I felt when I just did my chicken experiment in 2013. So I did that 2 months. All I did was bacon and eggs. And pretty much within 3 or 4 days, all of my symptoms disappeared. After the 2 months, started incorporating a little bit more vegetables again. And then in March 1st of 2020, I decided to go strict carnivore and haven't looked back since.
Awesome. All right. So a couple of things there that I can definitely relate to. One of them is the ulcerative colitis thing. Been there, done that as a much younger man in my early 20s. Yep. Same deal. Get rid of all the plants, get rid of all the grains. Problem solved in terms of that. The other thing I can relate to is being someone who is unable to participate in the Twitter community due to having unacceptable views and expressing them there, and also refusing to be told what I can and can't say and what I must delete or not delete. So it's a standoff, basically. There you go. So that's if people are wondering why I'm not posting using that platform. That's why. It's because they have banned me until I delete a tweet that I'm not going to delete because it was completely...
Yeah, same thing. January 10th of last year, got my account suspended. They told me if I cancel my appeal, they'll give me my account back. But out of principle, I'm not canceling the appeal. So yeah, I've been banned since January 10th of last year. Yeah. Or June 10th of last year.
Yeah. All right, good. All right, so the thing that kind of precipitated this discussion today was that you and I had a brief exchange in writing on, I think it was a YouTube platform or something, you know, several weeks back. And I'm like, well, you know, the written exchanges are often, it's easy to misconstrue what's going on. It's easy to get the wrong end of the stick. Just come on the channel and let's talk about it. And and you have done, so that's great. So welcome. There are a couple of topics that I want to sort of cover with you today to explore with you. I will take the position of being the one who asks the difficult questions. Don't take any of those things as a personal attack of any kind. It's all about teaching and learning, really. I've got 25 years experience as a tertiary educator, a college level educator, and kind of it's ingrained in my system to ask the difficult questions of people. So we can go through that. And I have to say, I've sat through this morning. I've had an opportunity to sit through and watch the first half of your discussion earlier that you had with Thomas and Justin. Mm-hmm. And I have to say that your approach to the first topic is not what I thought it was on the basis of the written exchange that we had. So that's an example of what I'm talking about, of how the, you know, keyboard warrior thing just never, you know, it's always best to get someone on and say, right, you're live on camera. Tell us where it's at.
Yeah, it's not uncommon for me to say something and then somebody misinterprets what I was trying to say. And then it turns out that we actually agreed on what we thought we disagreed with.
Yeah. Welcome to my world. It happens to me, you know, all the time where people will take something I've written as meaning something completely different to, you know, where I'm coming from and the context of it. So with all of that sort of to one side, what I'm going to do is I'm going to invite you to kind of introduce the first topic, which is calories in, calories out, our good old favorite, and give us your position on it. And then I'll start with the cross-examination with the questions and stuff and put you on the spot and see what you come up with.
Okay. All right. So, cool. Yeah, sure. So between 2004 and 2010, I was more of a proponent about calories in, calories out. And then when I developed my own health issues, then I completely threw that away. I am not a believer in the literal statement of calories don't matter. I believe it as a figurative statement. So the quality of the nutrition that you are getting from the foods that you consume is more important than the quantity of the calories that you are consuming. But that being said, I don't believe that you could just eat as much as you want and not expect to either gain fat or develop any health issues. So with regard to the whole calories in, calories out, yes, calories matter, but at the same time, there are so many variables that affect the calories out part of the equation that I don't even bother counting. I don't bother telling any of my clients or patients to count, because let's say you consume 2,000 calories today, 2,000 calories tomorrow, and your physical activity is the exact same. If you're more stressed tomorrow than you were today, that's going to affect the calories out. If you got a bad night of sleep, that's going to affect the calories out. There are so many variables that will affect it. So I find it pointless for most people to even bother tracking. One reason is that most people can't track accurately. And then the second reason is for those people that actually are able to track accurately, they'll do it for 3 or 4 days and then they're going to give up just because it becomes really tedious. So I believe they matter, but at the same time, I don't bother counting or telling anyone to count, just because for me, the quality of the food is more important than the quantity of the food.
Okay, cool. So as I say, that's a position statement. That's an attitude that's far more sensible than what it appeared to me that you were trying to say in writing. However, with that aside, thank you for that. Let me ask you the first question, which is, What are calories?
In the most simple term, they are a unit of heat measurement. So for every, a calorie is the amount of energy required to raise the temperature of water. So one calorie raises the temperature of water by 1 degree Celsius. So it's a unit of heat measurement, basically.
Right. Okay. So the mechanics of that measurement, as you quite rightly just said there, Stephen, basically what researchers do is they get a bolus of a certain amount, a certain weight of a certain food or food-like substance, and they put it inside a thing called a bomb calorimeter, which is a closed thermodynamic system. Mm-hmm. And what they do is they then pass a large electrical current through that food sample and rapidly combust it, poof, basically, into full combustion down to carbon dioxide, a bit of water is released, and some ash is left behind. Mm-hmm. And that releases an amount of energy, and that energy is transferred to a water bath outside of the closed system. And they measure how much 1 gram of water goes up in degrees Celsius in response to that release of energy. Okay. Fantastic. Let's go back a step from how does the energy get transferred. Let's go back a step further again. What is energy?
Are you referring to energy? Could you be a little bit more specific with the question?
Sure. Fair enough. Yep. Okay. So when someone says energy, specifically in the context of, let's say, energy in food, although it doesn't really matter because energy is energy, we're told.
Yeah.
I guess what I'm really looking for is, when I say what is energy, conceptually, or how would you define energy operationally? If you're a scientist, say, what operational definition is usually given to energy? Or if you go to a dictionary and look up energy, what do you get?
I'm thinking of two different definitions, because the definition of energy with regard to food and the definition, just the general definition of energy with regard to, when I think of energy, I think of kinetic energy, and for example, things like joules. So if you have one calorie, it's equal to, I believe, okay, I'm a little outdated in my nutrition physiology knowledge, but I believe one calorie is 4.18 joule or 4.180 joules of potential energy.
Oh, nearly 4.184.
4.184. Okay, I was off by 0.04.
Yeah.
So that is the, so that would be for every unit of energy that your body is able to take in. That is a, how do I want to word this? For every unit of energy that your body takes in, that is something that your body could store to be used at a later time for things like your physiological processes, for movement, for anything that is going to involve, how am I going to word this?
Let me just jump in for a moment there, Stephen, and make a couple of comments. And the first comment is, number one, we're not here to put Stephen on the spot and make Stephen feel uncomfortable. I did not provide him with any of these questions up front. I didn't warn him what I was going to do. The point I'm making here is that as soon as we start talking about this stuff, it gets really sticky really quickly, doesn't it? And there are people running around like, you know, his holy ignorance himself, Norton is the bloke I'm talking about, who wants to claim authority in this area. And for those that have been watching my channel this morning, I did a remake of one of my classic videos where we're dealing with Lane's video about calories in, calories out, where he comes on and his first statement is the first law of thermodynamics and the conservation of mass. To which we all laughed uproariously and went, well, you know, there goes your authority. straight out the window, son, because you clearly don't know what you're talking about. Let me help you out a bit with what I'm getting at with the definition of energy as a concept generally. If you go to a dictionary and look up energy, or if you talk to a scientist about energy, they'll give you an operational definition that says energy is a construct. It's a concept. It in and of itself is not an actual thing you can put a piece of kit on and measure.
Mm-hmm.
You can measure things like kilojoules, which is a unit of, it's touted to be a unit of energy. It's actually a specific unit of a particular form of energy, actually. Or you can measure calories, which are a specific measurement of a different form of energy again, in this case, heat. Or you can measure Newton meters of force. Or you can measure volts of electrical, you know, these are all different currencies of energy.
Yeah.
And they're interchangeable in the same way that you can interchange the US greenback dollar with UK pounds, with some loss. You know, there is going to be commissions involved, and you're going to have to, and you're also going to have the right piece of kit. You're going to have some agency that is able to transfer those funds from place to place, time to time for you. But the greenback dollar is no good across the counter in a store in the UK. In the same way that pound sterling is no good to buy a bottle of whiskey in the States, because it's not money there. It's a different. Yep. It's still money, but it's a different form of money from a different place and time. It's a different currency altogether. That's kind of what we're talking about here. So the actual definition they'll give you for energy is, it is a construct which describes the capacity to do work. And work in and of itself is defined then operationally as well. Newton defined it as force times distance, for example. And then you go and say, well, okay, great. What's work? And you look up the definition of work. Do you know what you get? It's the transfer of energy.
Mm.
Brilliant. So we've got a circular, self-supporting, circular insanity on what is this and what is that. So when you say what is energy, you have to understand that energy is a concept and not a thing we can measure. We can measure heat, and we do that using the calorie. And we do that by burning things rapidly inside closed thermodynamic systems and seeing how much heat is transferred to a bath of water outside the thing that we've just burned rapidly. Okay. Can human beings encapsulate heat and use heat for metabolic process?
Yes.
How? What's the mechanism by which they can do that?
How do humans use heat?
How would a human being encapsulate, collect heat, and use heat for metabolic process in some way?
Well, in terms of using heat for metabolic processes, one example would be, okay, like if you drink water,
mm-hmm.
your body would have to heat that water to your body's natural temperature. So water is room temperature. I'm in Canada, so we go by, you go by Celsius as well. Isn't going to be a problem. But room temperature is roughly 21, 22 degrees. The human body is roughly 37.
Yes.
So when you drink a glass of water, if you're drinking room temperature water, your body is going to have to heat that water by 15 degrees to be able to match your body's internal temperature.
Right. Okay. So what you're talking about there is an artifact of the second law of thermodynamics, actually, which is the one about entropy, mm-hmm. and by virtue of that, enthalpy a bit as well. And it says that if you have two bodies, your body and the body of the water that you've just consumed at room temperature. If there is a difference between the temperature of those two things, then temperature will flow from the hotter place to the colder place. So what will happen is that small amount of water that you drink will heat up, in all intents and purposes, to body temperature, because there's not much of it, and you'll lose a slight amount of heat into that water, and your body temperature will drop slightly, probably less than 1 degree Celsius, much less than 1 degree Celsius. As an exchange, the energy, again, there's a concept of energy, and the energy is now even, and there is a thermal equilibrium in play, and that invokes the zeroth law of thermodynamics, which says now the energy net flow will stop because the two things are pretty much even. So that's taking care of that one. But none of that was actually about metabolic process, except that you have expended, or you will expend, some energy in maintaining your body temperature homeostasis at exactly 37 degrees Celsius. So if you drank liters and liters of ice cold water, then obviously your metabolic rate would speed up, your brown adipose tissue would oxidize fat more rapidly to produce heat precisely to maintain your body temperature. So that's using previously stored potential energy in the form of carbohydrates, fats, alcohol, not so much amino acids. But that's not actually encapsulating heat and using heat to produce energy. So the question was, can human beings somehow capture heat from somewhere, absorb that heat somehow, and use that to produce energy for metabolic processes like whatever? The answer is no, not to any degree at all. Okay, you can collect some heat on your skin by putting it in direct sunlight, and some of the heat of the direct sunlight can be absorbed by the mitochondria in that tiny little amount just underneath your skin that those wavelengths can reach to, and those photons can excite some of the electrons and some of the metabolic processes that are going on there in the mitochondria and upregulate them slightly, very, very small amount. But can you live on nothing but sunlight? No,
no,
you cannot. Can you get into a hot bath of water and will that subserve your energy requirements? Do you have some piece of kit or machinery in your body that encapsulates and uses heat for energy? The answer is no. So, are calories, given the analogy about different currencies of energy, are calories a measurement of energy in the context of metabolic process in living human beings? The answer is no, they're not. So when people say, do calories matter? If your context is, do they matter in terms of one's body composition, one's fat storage, one's energy status, the answer is absolutely not. No, they're the wrong currency entirely. And then we get to the arguments about, can you accurately track your caloric intake? You've already spoken a little bit about the fact that people at home, there's no way they will be able to track their energy expenditure, even remotely closely, not without fantastically expensive, prohibitive pieces of scientific kit, which people don't have in the house.
So I get it would be literally, and I mean literally, impossible to accurately determine how many calories you are expending throughout the day.
Absolutely correct. Yeah. Spot on. The true is same of how many calories even you are actually consuming, let alone how much actual effective energy you're getting from the food you're eating, which, as I say, is a completely different currency. Metabolic energy is taken in the form of carbohydrates, fats, sometimes alcohols, and to a much lesser degree, some amino acids from time to time, depending on the macronutrient makeup of what you're eating. Not heat. And the fact that you could burn those things and get heat out of them doesn't mean that's what the energy that you're actually getting out of them is. So there's all of that. Then add to that the legal wiggle room that companies have got when they say how much energy is in a given foodstuff on the label. In most Western countries, it's 20% either way that they can be out by on that label legally and still sell you that thing.
The other thing that a lot of people, like with regard to being able to accurately track the amount of calories, a lot of people don't take into consideration things like rate of decay. Yep. So everything has a specific rate of decay. If I take a steak, I flash freeze it, put it in the freezer, a year later, it's going to have the same amount of nutrients or pretty damn close to the same amount of nutrients. But if I were to leave that same steak on the counter, a year later, it's going to decay into nothing. So let's hypothetically say that steak had 1,000 calories. A year later, it's going to have 0 calories. So the longer that you go between the actual food that you are consuming to actually ingesting it in your body, that's going to affect it as well.
Yeah.
So if you literally either kill an animal, eat it right there on the spot, the amount of calories in that animal is going to be different than if you were to consume that exact same animal a month down the road.
Yes. Absolutely.
Which is one of the reasons why a lot of people are not going to be able to track properly, because even if they did know how many calories were in the food that they were consuming, they only know how many calories were in that food at the time that it was measured, and they don't know how much of that, the nutrients and how much of the actual energy has decayed by the time they actually ingested into their body. So by the time they actually ingest it, there's going to be less nutrients in it and there's going to be less energy as well.
Right. So then add in the 20% legal error that you're allowed on the label.
Yeah.
Add on top of that the thermic effect of protein and the fact that protein is hardly used for oxidative process whatsoever anyway. It's used to be incorporated into your body systems to grow things like hair, but not for me, bastards. You know, that kind of stuff. Add to that that we don't use heat for energy. We use chemical process for energy. And as such, actually what we do is we lose some heat to entropy due to the inefficiency of that system. How are you going to remotely even get any kind of gauge at all on the actual effect of energy that you're taking in? Then you've correctly said you can't measure how much energy you're spending either remotely without either living inside a closed bomb calorimeter, a room, a metabolic room, which no one's got at home, and or with gas analysis mask on 24/7 to get an idea on your respiratory gas exchanges and what you really have breathed in and breathed out, etc. And then there's the other one that I really like to go to, which is when people tell me about, you know, their calories in and calories out, I often ask them, great. And so how many calories were in your feces this morning?
Yeah. There's actually more calories in fecal matter than there is in protein or carbs.
So, yeah, cool. And the other one about calories in, calories out as well that you can throw at people is, all right, there are, in a reasonable sized lump of coal, there are tens and probably hundreds of thousands of calories in that lump of coal. I challenge you to get fat eating coal. Go ahead.
With regard to the coal example, there's a difference between calories consumed and calories stored. So if you were to consume enough coal, you would either vomit it out or you would shit it out.
Yep.
So if you were to vomit out or shit it out or shit out the coal, then you would be expending those calories. So let's say you consume 1,000 calories worth of coal and you vomit it all out.
Yes.
You've expended 1,000 calories just through the act of vomiting, plus through the act of peristaltic contractions, you are expending even more energy just through that act. So I would push back a little bit on the coal example, just for those reasons. Because you could consume 1,000 calories worth of coal, but it doesn't necessarily mean that your body is going to store and be able to use those calories. Because you can consume it, but then you're going to immediately evacuate it.
All right. So how does that differ from the example of various foods and food-like substances?
Oh, it doesn't. If you if you consume 1,000 calories of a particular food, and then that food doesn't agree with you, and you just shit it right out, then you didn't really you consume those calories, but you didn't actually store them to be used at a later time.
Right, or used immediately.
Yeah.
Either or. Exactly. Right. So there's another reason why you can't track effectively how much actual effective energy you have taken in. Mm-hmm. By tracking your calories at home, by being a good, dutiful little boy or girl and putting all your inputs, even accurately, into some bit of software to tell you that you've been a good boy or a good girl. Mm. Right. Okay. So calories in, calories out. Is it any good as a tool to use in order to have a predictable or utilitarian effect on your body composition in some way?
If you are a healthy individual and you are fairly accurate with the way in which you track, I mean, if you consume, you could call it calories, you could call it pounds, grams, whatever you want. If you consume less of a specific food, you are going to decrease your mass if the amount of food that you consume is not enough that your body requires. And if you consume more food than your body requires, more calories, more grams, more pounds of that food, you are going to increase your mass. See, here's the thing with the whole calories in, calories out. Like for me, calories is just a unit of measurement. So when people say calories don't matter, it really depends on what you mean by calories don't matter. If you are talking about the quality of the food that you are consuming, then no, calories don't matter at all. Because at the end of the day, 1,000 calories of sugar and 1,000 calories of ribeye steak are going to have completely different effects with regard to your physiology. But if you are simply using calories just as a unit of measurement, then if you consume more calories, more grams, more pounds than you need, then you are going to gain mass and vice versa. If you consume less than you need, then you will lose mass.
Okay. That being said, explain the following to me, if you please.
Okay.
Between January 1 this year and January 14 this year, I increased my caloric intake from roughly 1,700 to 1,800 per day, kcals, up to 8,500 to 8,750 kcal per day without fail, every day for 14 days. What happened to my body mass during those 14 days?
I'm going to assume, because you're asking me this question, that it went down.
Correct. It did go down. It went down by 10 kilograms, of which 7.5 of those kilograms were water, absolutely.
Yeah.
The other 2.5 were fat, according to my biometric impedance scale. So I consumed 5.5 to 6 times my caloric intake for 14 days solid, my baseline, what it's been steadily and consistently for 5 years previous to that. I've increased that by 5 or 6 times over for 2 weeks. And I have lost actual body mass. Take the water out of it. 2.5 kilograms of fat came off my body in those 14 days. Explain that to me.
And the food, so the increase in calories that you were consuming, was it from different food sources, or were you consuming 1,000 calories of ribeye steak, and then you upped it to 5,000 calories of ribeye steak, or were you consuming 1,000 calories of broccoli, and then you changed the source of the calories to ribeye steak?
Okay, so I'm going to answer that question with a question, which I know is very rude, but I'm going to do it.
Yeah.
Aren't all calories the same?
No.
Well, if you look again, at the way they are operationally defined, yes, they are.
Yes, they are, in terms of all calories are equal in terms of their energy potential, but they are not all the same in terms of how your body is going to react once you ingest them. So, for example, the thermic effect. If you consume protein, 20 to 30% is going to be burned off through the thermic effect. With carbs, it'll be 10 to 15. With fat, it'll be 3%. So if you consume 1,000 calories of carbohydrates versus 1,000 calories of protein, you're still getting 1,000 calories, but you're only getting 700 to 800 usable calories of potential energy from the protein, as opposed to 850 to 900 usable energy from the carbohydrates. And then on top of that, there's also the enzymatic function of each individual. So we have different groups of enzymes to break down different foods. We have proteases for protein, lipases for fats, amylases for carbohydrates. So if somebody is consuming, if somebody naturally has more proteases and lipases circulating throughout their body, then for somebody who's consuming a high carbohydrate diet, that diet is not going to be right for their body, and they're going to store a lot more of those, a lot more of that food as fat, as opposed to things like protein and fat. Whereas if somebody has just a normal amount of amylases circulating through their body, but they have an inadequate, let's say somebody has something like a lipase deficiency or a protease deficiency, then for that type of an individual, they're not going to be able to properly break down and absorb all of the nutrients found in the proteins and fats. So their body, if they were to consume more of a high fat, high protein diet, they're going to store onto more fat than the other individual. So the calorie content between 1,000 calories of broccoli and 1,000 calories of ribeye, it's both 1,000 calories, but the effect on the individual based off of their enzymatic profile is going to dictate which one is going to cause them to store more fat and which one is going to cause them to burn more fat.
Right. So the amount of calories is actually not the thing that's important here, is what you're saying. Yeah?
No. Calories matter, but nutrition is more important than calories. You could consume 1,000 calories of two different foods, and the 1,000 of one food will have a completely different effect on your body composition than 1,000 of the other. So for me, I respond really well to if I wanted to get lean really fast, all I need to do is, if I go high protein, high fat, I can get pretty lean pretty quickly. If I were to consume more protein than fat, my body composition, my body fat percentage would go up, because when I consume a lot of protein, for me personally, my body does not react very well to it. So I tend to store fat. And I'll give you an example. This was 2 years ago. So I ended up, when I first started strict carnivore, I do a rotation diet as well, or at least at the time I was doing a rotation diet, and I've been doing that since 2010. I don't know if you're familiar with rotation diet.
Not really, but I presume it's like a cyclic diet where you move from one form of diet primarily to another and back again over a period of time, would be my guess.
Yeah, kind of. So the concept behind the rotation diet is you want to consume a food from a given food family, and then you want to avoid consuming that food for a specific amount of days until your body has had a time to pass through it. So you have your colon retention time and your colon transit time. Your colon transit time, the moment you consume a food to the moment it pops out the back end, that's your colon transit time. Your retention time is the last time that you see it. So if you are consuming multiple foods throughout the same day, you're not going to know which food is having a negative effect. So the benefits of a rotation diet is, if you are consuming a food once every 5 days, after 5 days, that food is going to be eliminated from your system. So if you get a negative reaction to it, you are going to know that it was that particular food. And so that's why I do the rotation diet, just because I find that it works really well for my digestion. But when I was doing the rotation diet back in March of 2020, to make my life easier, I just ordered everything from ButcherBox because it came prepackaged, could just cook it up, no problem. And I never bothered counting, but about a month and a half in, my weight dropped down to 146 pounds, which I have not been 146 pounds since I was 21, was the first time I broke the 150 mark. And I was feeling really self-conscious because it looked like I didn't even work out. So I decided to switch from the rotation diet, and I did nothing but medium ground beef and beef liver for 28 straight days. And I fried it up in butter. And normally when I do medium ground beef and beef liver, I'll do 1 pound of each. And if I were to do 1 pound of each, my body composition is going to stay the same. So I ended up adding an additional pound of medium ground beef. And over the course of 28 days, consuming nothing but medium ground, 2 pounds of medium ground beef, 1 pound of beef liver, and I would fry it in roughly 62-ish grams of butter, I ended up gaining 24 pounds in 28 days. 22 pounds of that 24 was fat, 2 pounds was water. And then I ended up doing the math. So because everything in ButcherBox comes in prepackaged sizes, I ended up adding up the amount of calories that I was consuming, and it was about 1,600-ish calories, which explains why I ended up dropping down to 146 pounds. And then the medium ground beef that I get is 78 to 82%. So I averaged it out to about 80% fat, or 80% lean and 20% fat. And I can't remember the exact number off the top of my head, but it was somewhere around 4,600 calories. And when I ended up doing the math over the course of the 4 weeks that I was doing that, I was within a couple pounds of what I would have expected to have gained if calories in, calories out mattered.
Okay. So all of that having been said, I'm still kind of looking for an explanation of how it is that I lost 2.5 kilograms of fat while consuming nearly 9,000 kcal a day, which was 5 and 6 times as much as my typical intakes previous to that over a 2-week period. How did that happen if calories matter?
Well, calories matter, but nutrition is more important. So if the
but I'm still looking for an explanation mechanistically. Yeah. How did I lose 2.5 kilograms of fat eating 5 and 6 times the calories that I was eating previously? If calories matter, how did that happen, Stephen?
So if let's say hypothetically, I know nothing about your medical history. So let's say that the way your enzymatic function and profile, if you have more proteases and more lipases circulating throughout your system than amylases, if you went from something like a carbohydrate diet to a carnivore diet, then you would burn through those a lot faster than you would through carbohydrates. So you could lose fat at a much higher rate, consuming more calories of protein and fats, and you could gain fat eating a significant less amount of carbohydrates, just because for your body specifically, that is the energy source that is best suited to fuel your body.
And everybody else's body, because we all have the same genetics. We're all Homo sapiens sapiens human beings.
Well, it sounds
very much to me, Stephen, like what you're saying is actually what matters is the makeup of your diet, not the caloric content of it.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Yeah. Good. That's what we're getting to. So calories don't matter. Excellent. Good. All right. Next topic. How are you going for time? Do you want to keep going? Have you got a bit more up your sleeve?
I've treated all my patients and clients for the day. So
excellent. Good. So you're up for it. Okay. What else did you want to talk about? You wanted to talk about training a bit as well, didn't you?
Oh yeah, we can talk about anything: lifestyle, training, nutrition.
Yep. Okay. Well, I think we've done a fairly major chunk on nutrition, on the calories thing. That was fun.
I did look up. I don't know if it was a video or a post that you made, but I know that you are not a fan of cardio.
I am not. Yeah. Correct.
So yeah, we're on the same page with that. I studied under Charles Poliquin for a decade, and he was not a fan of cardio. And going back to the whole, this kind of relates to the diet in a way with the whole paleo diet, because what would our ancestors have done? So with regards to cardio, really jogging is something that we never would have done in a real life scenario. We either would have walked to get from point A to B, or we would have sprinted because we were running away from something and we needed to save our lives. So on the topic of cardio, that's actually one thing that I would like to talk about. Uh-huh. A lot of people, they tend to think that cardio is the secret to getting lean. Me personally, I don't do any cardio at all. And when I say cardio, I mean aerobic exercise, because technically any exercise that elevates your heart rate is cardiovascular exercise. So when I say cardio, I'm referring specifically to aerobic exercise for anybody.
Actually, all exercise is aerobic too, because you can't exercise whatsoever without using oxygen. So that's a terminology that's not going to work either, unfortunately.
So if you are doing more powerlifting, let's say you're just doing if you're doing less than 10 seconds worth of work or something like that, Yes, you are going to require some oxygen, but you're going to rely a lot less than you would if you were doing more longer duration work.
I think you're probably talking there about the relative contributions to total energy production from the consumption of oxygen per unit time and all that kind of stuff. You probably want to read a couple of papers I've written on this one to bring yourself fully up to speed on the workings of human physiology. There is this idea out there that we have nominally, usually what's taught, even to this day, and it's still being taught for some ridiculous reason, is that you have three different energy systems in your body. Is that familiar, or is that what you were taught?
Yeah.
So they would have said to you, you've got an aerobic system, and you've got two anaerobic systems, one of which is the lactic system and one of which is the alactic system. So you've got your PCR system, you've got your glycogenolysis system, and you've got your oxidative phosphorylation. And the idea that they will have taught you, because they tried to teach it to me as well and failed because I could see straight through it, is that your body has a choice as to which of those systems it's going to use.
See, that's where a lot of people misinterpret the way the energy systems works, because it's not like it's a light switch where you go from the aerobic system and then that shuts off and you go to anaerobic. The proportion of the systems that you are going to be using, you're never going to be 100% one system, 0% the other. You're always using a mix of the systems. So when I say aerobic exercise, I'm not saying that it is 100% aerobic, 0% anaerobic, and vice versa. Yeah. What I'm saying is you require a higher proportion of that energy system during specific types of exercise. So if you are doing long duration exercise, you're still going to be using the anaerobic system. It's just a higher proportion of the energy that you're going to be using is going to be coming from the aerobic system during longer duration. So when I say aerobic exercise, I'm not saying that it's a light switch that turns on and off and under 10 seconds it is 0% aerobic and only 100% anaerobic. So I just wanted to clarify that.
Okay. All right. So the next thing to kind of get one's head around is that you actually don't have three separate energy systems at all. That's a fallacy. It's a falsehood. If you're going to break it down that way and say, well, you have different energy systems, then really you'd have to teach four and not three, because there's a fourth one that's not even taught under this three system idea that's being taught. And I'm talking about the purine nucleotide system as the fourth one for people that want to go and look that one up. And that would be your third so-called anaerobic system. However, the mistake that's being made there is that, okay, let's take us back a step again and let's look at this mechanistically. Sliding filament theory in muscle tissues, where your actin and myosin filaments are sliding over each other to facilitate a muscle twitch of any given muscle fiber. Where is the feel coming from to subserve that sliding filament theory to cause that muscle fiber to twitch? And it doesn't matter what. Where is the energy coming from? What is the energy source? We know that ATP is the actual transaction agent. We know that ATP is the thing that cocks the myosin heads and causes the sliding filaments to slide across each other. We know that that's activated by sliding the tropomyosin complex out of the way on the binding site using calcium as the signaling agent. But where is the energy for that ATP coming from?
Good question.
I'll answer the question because I know that most people don't know this at all, and I wouldn't expect you to know this. In fact, I've spoken to people with PhDs in exercise physiology that don't know this and can't answer that question. So it's not a judgment. But here's the answer. ALL, all in capital letters, underline it as many times as you like, boldface, italic, whatever you like, all energy for muscle contraction in all muscle fibers of all muscle fiber types are 100% reliant entirely at all times on glycogenolysis. You have a bunch of glycogen stored around and pervading and within the sliding filaments of the contractile machinery of the muscle fibers, and all the ATP, all of it, for all muscle contractions, comes from glycogenolysis, enzymatic glycogenolysis, not using any oxygen whatsoever at that stage of proceedings. So how much glycogen is stored in a muscle fiber? Well, depending on muscle fiber type, morphology, etc., and training status a little bit, somewhere between enough glycogen for one or at most two muscle twitches, after which that muscle fiber would be completely drained of glycogen, and as such would undergo irreversible tetanus, would not contract any further, would not relax either, would become a stiff thing, and would become dead, necrotic, within 4.5 minutes after that point in time. All muscle contractions. There are no aerobic muscle contractions. There is no oxygen involved in muscle contractions. Okay, fine. So what is oxygen involved in as far as exercise physiology goes? Well, oxygen is consumed by mitochondria, and in so doing, what the mitochondria do is inside the mitochondria, inside the membrane of the mitochondria, what they do is they take ADP and inorganic phosphate, PI, and they ram those things together to make ATP. And then what happens? That ATP is immediately hydrolyzed by that mitochondria. People think mitochondria exude ATP out into the cell cytosol. No, they do no such thing. They use that ATP themselves that they've just created using that oxygen. Then what does the cell that is hosting the mitochondria do? It leverages that mitochondrial energy production. And on the other side of the membrane, on like a gear, if you like, it takes an inorganic phosphate and a creatine molecule and rams them together and makes phosphocreatine. That phosphocreatine then builds up in between muscle contractions in that cell cytosol, and it's that phosphocreatine which is hydrolyzed at the site of the glycogen storage so that we can put the glucose back together and the glycogen back together ready for the next muscle contraction. So what we have there is three gears in a gearbox, not three different energy systems. Take out any one of those gears out of a muscle cell, and it will contract once, or at maximum twice, after which it will die. So there's no such thing as anaerobic exercise, any more than there's any such thing as aerobic exercise. It's all just exercise at different intensities, relative power outputs, whatever, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Does that explanation change your whole perspective on how the muscles work? It should, if it didn't.
Definitely going to have to look into it a little bit more.
Everybody does. That's my problem with exercise physiologists, Stephen. They have no fucking idea what they're talking about. They think we've got three different energy systems. No, we don't. Wrong.
Yeah. The reason I brought it up, the whole aerobic system in general, was with relation to what we were talking about cardio. I was coming at it more from a physical therapy standpoint, because I was going to explain why I'm not a fan of cardio.
Go for it. Please do.
So one of the things that I do aside from my coaching practice is I own a physiotherapy clinic as well. Mm-hmm. And for any of your viewers who are big cardio fans, I was just going to explain why, from a physical therapy standpoint, a lot of cardiovascular modalities are not good for most people.
Cool.
So one of the reasons is, if you are very heavy and overweight, you shouldn't be running, just because it's way too much pressure and force being transferred through the joints.
Yep.
So depending on your running technique, anywhere from 3 to 8 times of force is going to be transferred through the joints. So let's say you have somebody who's obese, 300 pounds. Best case scenario, if they have really efficient running technique, that's 900 pounds through the ankle, knee, hip, that's going to be transferred, which is a lot of pressure on the joints. If you're 300 pounds, chances are you're not going to have very efficient running techniques. So the chances are you're going to be on the higher end, closer to that 8. So you are going to be looking at 2,400 pounds of force transferring into your ankle, your knee, your hip, back, all the way up. So that's one of the reasons. The other reason is most people, I would say over 95% of patients that I've assessed, you're going to find that they have overpronated arches on the foot. So flat foot, they have valgus knees, the knees cave in. They have antiverted femurs, an antiverted pelvis, so an anterior tilt. And every single one of those little postural dysfunctions is going to exacerbate symptoms. So if you have poor running technique, plus you have all of those different postural faults, it is just going to absolutely destroy you. So for people who are overweight, have postural dysfunction, doing any type of cardiovascular exercise, if you are going to do it, you're better off walking. Learn how to walk properly. Then once you could walk properly, either walk or sprint. But jogging makes absolutely no sense, because when you're sprinting, you have to have your weight forward. So your weight is going to be in your toes. And because the weight's in your toes, your ankle, it's going to act as a shock absorber. So all of that force, your ankle is going to be able to absorb it. But when you jog, you have no choice. You're not sprinting fast enough. So your weight, it's going to be on the heel. And when you pound away on the heel, your ankle is going to absorb all of that force. You're not going to be able to get any shock absorption through it. So for anybody who is watching this that is trying to lose weight and they think, okay, let me go run because that'll help me. It's cardiovascular exercise. Everybody says I need to do cardio to lose weight. Like, yeah, you're going to expend energy while you're running, but the damage that you're going to do to your joints is just not worth the payoff. And then a lot of people will want to do things like, oh, you know what, the treadmill, it's not as bad as pavement, because on pavement, it's a solid ground. The treadmill, it's going to absorb some impact. The treadmill's even worse than pavement. So one of the things with regard to the treadmill is because the belt is propelling your legs back, what happens is you don't have to use your glutes, your hamstrings, any of your extensors, right? So your glutes, your hamstrings, your calves to propel your leg backward, because the belt is going to do it for you. So what happens is you end up overactivating your hip flexors, your knee extensors, and then all of your muscles that are responsible for the propulsion part, your hamstrings, your glutes, those are going to be underactivated.
Yeah.
Now, with regard to those, how it relates to a physical therapy standpoint, the postural fault, right? You have pronated feet, valgus ankles, anterior pelvic tilt. When we look at the muscles that are responsible for example, anteriorly tilting the pelvis, we have the rectus femoris, we have the psoas major. Those are going to be responsible for anteriorly tilting it. And then in terms of posteriorly tilting, we have all the hamstrings mixed with the exception of the short head of the biceps femoris. You have the glute max. So because the belt is propelling your leg for you and you don't have to actually use your extensors, what happens is your glutes, your hamstrings, they all become underactivated and they become more taut. So because they become more taut, what happens is you end up exacerbating an anterior pelvic tilt, you exacerbate an antiverted femur, you exacerbate valgus knees, overpronation of the feet. So a lot of people think they should be running to lose weight or even going on the treadmill to lose weight, it's actually a terrible idea, because from a biomechanical standpoint, it is just going to absolutely destroy you from the ground up.
Yeah.
So if you were going to do any type of cardiovascular exercise, if you're overweight, the best thing is going to be very low impact stuff. So if you are going to like water, some type of swimming, something like that, if you're going to do a bike, you could do the bike, but you would definitely want to stay away from running and the treadmill.
Right. Yeah. Okay. Excellent information and well said. And absolutely, I agree with all of those things. Biomechanically, what you said is absolutely spot on. What we used to teach on running on a treadmill for any amount of time, and I'm not suggesting running on a treadmill is a good thing. I'm not. I don't think people should do it at all. But if you must, for some reason, here's what I would suggest to minimize the risks that Stephen was just talking about. Set the incline on the treadmill to 2.5%. And that biomechanically fixes that issue. Number one, It forces you to get up onto the balls of your feet because of your balance of mass will change to such a degree that you're now in effect leaning forward, although you're actually maintaining a vertical posture. Secondly, because you're now running basically in effect uphill, that reactivates all of the glutes and hammies and all that kind of stuff. So there's a solution to that one. That said, don't run on a treadmill or indeed on a road or anything else for any period of time. Don't go and jog miles and miles and miles and miles. Don't sit on a bike for miles and miles and miles. Don't do anything with large muscle groups, rhythmic muscle contractions at a relatively moderate percentage of your nominally VO2 max for hours and hours at a time, or even an hour at a time, several times a week, or any of that kind of stuff. We've heard the biomechanical reasons why not to do stuff.
I actually have a different solution from the one that you just proposed. Yep. And it's kind of become a running joke in my clinic because I started saying this as a joke, but biomechanically, it actually makes sense. If you are going to use the treadmill, the best use of the treadmill would be to run backward on the treadmill, because by running backward, what happens is your hamstrings and glutes that normally would be the underactivated muscles because the belt is doing the work now become the overactivated muscles because you have to actually bring your hips into extension. And then the quadriceps and your hip flexors that normally would become overactivated because you have to actively bring them into flexion of the hip and extension of the knee, because you're walking backwards, now those become passive muscles. So if you were to run backward on a treadmill, you would actually be better able to correct postural faults than if you were to run regularly on a treadmill, where you would exacerbate all of those postural faults. So my advice to people is, if you are going to run on a treadmill, run backward on a treadmill.
Yep, that will work too. Excellent. Good stuff. All right. So here's the physiological reasoning to not do long lasting rhythmic, what they normally call aerobic or cardiovascular training for hours and hours on end during the week. Here it is. Also, Stephen, you were probably taught that there are three different muscle fiber types: type 1, type 2A, and type 2B, which is sometimes called type 2X. That sound familiar?
Yep.
Right. That's also bullshit. It's also complete nonsense. No. What you have is a continuum of muscle fiber morphologies, which starts at the type 1 end and ends at the other end, the type 2X or type 2B end. And those tissues are morphologically the size and expression of the myosin actin chains, the number of mitochondria, the metabolic processes within those cells. They exist on a continuum between here and there. There aren't three categories. Any muscle fiber whatsoever will respond to the way it is chronically activated, innervated, and used by you during your activities during the week, and will actually change physically, chemically, mitochondria-wise, and all of that stuff. It will get bigger or smaller. It will change its metabolic makeup, its number of mitochondria, to suit your training status. If you do a lot of moderate intensity, and when I say moderate, I mean the stuff in the middle. So I'm talking about
70-80%.
Up to 70-80% at the top end, down to 60% at the low end, maybe. Mm-hmm. That's what they will call the middle zone, or the zone B, or the aerobic zone, or the fat burning zone, the stuff where they'll tell you to do hours and hours of work in that zone. I'm telling you, stay right the hell out of that zone at all times. Here's why. What I've just said about your muscle morphology changing, I'll give you some examples of it. I'll give you one example. There are many, but I'll just give you one. Think about two blokes who are both genetically very, very similar. Now, we're all very similar because we're all human beings, every one of us. But these two guys are even more similar because they're both of African descent, one more immediately than the other one. One is African descent by way of Africa, this generation, and the other one is of African descent by way of the Caribbean, Jamaican. Okay? And obviously, I'm talking about versus you. Look at the morphology on those two gentlemen. Forget their height difference. That's not what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
I'm talking about the size of their skeletons, the robustness of their skeletons, their skeletal structures with respect to their height. I'm talking about the muscle mass on the on those two gentlemen. Compare one to the other. There is no comparison, is there? And I'm talking about, just look at, the man is almost skeletal in his appearance, and that's not a judgment. What I mean is his muscle mass is very, very slight, because exactly his muscle morphology has adapted to the way he's training and has got more and more type 1, more and more aerobic, which means less and less fiber diameter on each individual fiber, which means his overall muscle mass is smaller and smaller and smaller. Plus, that gives him an advantage on his power to weight ratio for carrying that weight, which he has to carry around with him when he runs. His body is absolutely adapted to what he's doing physically in terms of that middle distance running stuff. Unfortunately, number one, you, me, Joe Bloggs down the road, doesn't have the number of hours per week has to go and run. So we're not going to be able to achieve that anyway. What we're going to get is a slimming down of our muscle mass, a loss of muscle mass. And if we're doing any strength training, hypertrophy training in the gym, what we're actually also doing is we're doing antagonistic training. We're training against ourselves. Mm-hmm. Now, what happens when you reduce your muscle mass? Well, your basal metabolic rate drops 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. Running also makes you, and other aerobic forms of exercise, also makes you feel hungry. So your appetite remains the same, or indeed even gets even more. You crave carbohydrates, which you absolutely should not eat, and you don't have the muscle mass to burn that stuff off. So you're going to get obese, or you're going to tend towards muscle loss and fat storage. You're going to tend towards type 2 diabetes. You're going to tend towards chronic systemic inflammation. And your heart muscle is going to respond by way of hypertrophying, getting bigger and thicker, which is going to predispose you in later life to actually a higher likelihood of cardiac issues, not a lower one. So physiologically, human beings should exercise well, well below even the so-called aerobic zone, so walking, or they should be doing high-intensity sprint and repeat, resistance training, sets of strength work, hypertrophy training, sprinting up and down hills with resistance bands, whatever else, not ever, ever in the middle. So that's the explanation for that.
Yeah. One of the other things, too, with regard to like what we're talking about right now, is we should really get into people's specific goals. So what you're saying right now, if you are concerned with optimizing health and that's your main objective, then yes. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, it doesn't matter what your goal is. I've been doing this for next month. It'll be 18 years in August. And every single person that has come to me, one of three goals. They either want to look better, feel better, perform better.
Yep.
So if somebody's objective is to feel better, then yes, what you were saying is correct. If somebody's objective is to look better, and the way in which they would like to look better would be to accumulate muscle tissue, then what you're saying wouldn't be the optimal approach for that specific goal. So that's why, like, when it comes to me, I would, for the longest time, I was very, very health oriented, and it didn't matter who came to me, what their goal was. I would always just try to force my beliefs onto them. So one of the things that I have changed over the years is focusing on the person's goal that is coming to me. So if somebody is looking to optimize their health, then yes, you would want to stay away from that range because it doesn't make sense to train in that range. But if somebody is trying to build muscle, then ideally they would want to alternate between different intensity zones. So they wouldn't want to avoid the 60 to 80% range, but they also wouldn't want to only stick in that range as well.
Okay, I'm going to have to completely disagree.
With which part?
Hypertrophy training, the gaining of muscle mass, is absolutely a top-end high-intensity activity, and you absolutely, for the exact reasons I've just given in terms of muscle morphology changes, you must absolutely avoid the middle zone for hypertrophy training as well.
For hypertrophy, this is just based off of my experience with clients. Going between the different zones is going to achieve the best results for hypertrophy. If you always stay in the high intensity zone, like let's say you're always training above 80%, that'll be really great for things like relative strength and absolute strength. If you're always training below 60%, that'll be really good at just more endurance-based training.
But hypertrophy training is supra-maximal resistance training. That's how you gain muscle mass. If you're talking about putting a little bit of muscle mass on, a little bit, then yes, middle zone training will put some of that on with respect to being sedentary. However, that will also predispose you in the long run to suboptimal performance, suboptimal cardiovascular health, actually a shorter lifespan as an athlete and probably a shorter lifespan in life as well.
That's why I specifically said differentiating between the goals, whether your goal is to look better, feel better, perform better. Mm. If you just want to look better, you want to put on muscle, you don't give a shit if you end up feeling like shit, then at the end of the day, that middle zone will help you get to your end goal. Like, let's say, for example, you want to be a pro bodybuilder, right? Your main objective, you just want to have the most amount of muscle you could possibly fit onto your frame. If you're always training high intensity or low intensity and you avoid the middle, you're not going to be able to put on the maximum amount of muscle possible if you avoid that middle zone.
I'm going to disagree again. Absolutely nonsense in my mind on that one. If you are a professional bodybuilder and you want to put on the most muscle mass possible, there's only one option available to you to be competitive, and that is to take the juice.
Yeah, but at the same time, you still need to you need to accumulate enough volume in order to elicit hypertrophy response. If you are training at very, very high intensity, in order for you to accumulate the amount of volume that you would need to elicit that hypertrophy response, you would be training for hours every single day.
No, nonsense. No, not at all. Yeah. No, still no.
Yeah.
No, still no. Yeah. No, still no. You do not need to train for hours and hours to get hypertrophy happening. You need to do it appropriately.
No, you do not. But if you were to only train in the very high intensities, then you would need to train for a lot longer than you would if you were training in that middle zone, specifically for the purpose of gaining the maximum amount of muscle possible.
No, I disagree entirely. No, I don't know where you're getting these ideas from, Stephen. I really don't.
Well, look, okay, let's break it down. So let's say you are training at very high intensity, right? You're training 90%+ intensity, so you're powerlifting style. You're going for 5 repetitions or less.
Right, well, that's strength training. That's not hypertrophy training.
No, that's what I'm saying. So, like, let's say we were to train in that high-intensity zone where you are doing 5 or less. So you're training for strength, not hypertrophy, or not, like, hypertrophy in the typical sense. Mm-hmm. In order for you to accumulate the amount of volume required to build up enough muscle, what's going to happen is
When you say build up muscle, you are now talking about hypertrophy training. And strength training is not hypertrophy training. It's strength training.
No, I know.
Are we talking about strength or are we talking about hypertrophy? The training methodologies are different for those outcomes. Which do you want? Do you want to be stronger or do you want to have bigger muscle mass?
That's what I'm saying. If you train, because you're saying to avoid the 60 to 80%.
Or hypertrophy, actually.
For strength, there's a lot of evidence that suggests that you need to train with heavy weights in order to increase your strength. And when I say heavy, I'm talking about high intensity, like 85%+.
Do you mean percentage of 1 RM max, or are we still talking about aerobic endurance capacity?
No, we're talking about percentage of 1 repetition maximum right now.
Okay, well, that's a different story because now we're talking about different currencies again. Because
I thought we went away from the old time. I thought we switched topics right now. Because right now I'm just talking
We need to operationally define what we're talking about. And if we're talking about percent of 1 RM, then for strength training, I would give you a different range of your 1 RM and a different rep range to what I would give you if you wanted hypertrophy.
Yeah. So
my argument about avoiding the middle is specifically with respect to the continuum of oxygen uptake. Mm-hmm. and heart rate max. Mm-hmm. All but strength and going, resistance
going
training
back,
is super
going
maximal.
Going back to what you were saying about the best way to approach hypertrophy would be training in the high intensity. Yes. You can build muscle in that high intensity zone, but if all you ever do is train at high intensity.
What do you mean by high intensity? Let's operationally define it.
85%+ of your one repetition maximum.
Right.
So if you're constantly training at 85%+ of your one repetition maximum, mm-hmm. the amounts of volume, in order to accumulate the amount of volume that you would need to build the most amount of muscle possible, you would, first of all, if you're training at 85%+ intensity, your rest periods are going to be significantly longer than if you're training at a moderate intensity. So that's going to lengthen the duration of the workout. Plus, on top of that, the more intense the workout, the more sets you're going to have to perform to get that same type of response. So let's say hypothetically, if I wanted to build muscle, I could train at, let's say, 70% intensity, do the typical bodybuilding workout, right? 3 to 4 sets, 8 to 12 repetitions. If you are training at 3 to 4 sets of 8 to 12 repetitions, in order to build that same amount of muscle on a high intensity program, because you're training with less repetitions, your volume is going to be significantly lower. So you would need a much higher number of sets to accumulate the same amount of volume. So in order for you to accumulate,
you won't actually achieve it. You cannot get hypertrophy by training at 85% plus doing sets of probably 3 reps maximum in any number of sets. It won't work.
That's fine.
I have no argument with that. Mm-hmm. If you want hypertrophy, then you need to do sets of 8. And actually, the literature tells us that 95% plus of the gains in terms of hypertrophy from that activity is obtained in the first and second sets. The third and fourth sets, which is 50% of the work if you're doing 4 sets, will only give you another 5% bonus on top, and as such is probably contraindicated. So it's not about volume. It's about specifically, correctly selecting the right intensity and matching that with the right volume. And 4 sets is too much. Interesting.
I was just using that as one example.
Sure.
And with regards to the sets, it also depends on the level of the person being trained. If you are a beginner, then the more of a beginner you are, the less sets you would require to elicit the same response as somebody who's more advanced. If you're a beginner, you can build muscle on 3 sets. If you are like somebody like me, I've been training since 1999. So I've been training a little over 23 years right now. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to be able to build muscle on 3 sets of 8 to 12 repetitions.
Then your weight's not enough. You need more weight. You don't need more sets. You need more weight.
No, even if the intensity is at the proper amount. In order for me to build muscle, I need a high amount of sets and a high intensity. So if I'm training at 85%+, I would need to do something like 6 to 12 sets, as opposed to 3 to 4 for a beginner on something like 8 to 12 repetitions.
So do you think you're somewhere near your genetically predisposed maximum muscle carriage without taking the juice?
I think the most muscle I would be able to gain naturally would be maybe 10 pounds heavier than I am right now. I don't believe I would be able to hit 180 lean. I could hit 180, but there's no way I'm going to be a lean 180 with my genetics. And
okay. Is that last 5 kilograms worth it?
Oh, I'm just referring to in general. Like if somebody's goal is they want to build the most amount of muscle possible, they don't care about health, they don't care about performance. All they care about is just building the most amount.
The answer is two sets, not three, not four, not five, not 12. It's 2 sets, and it's 2 sets of 8 rep maximum weight.
Sorry, say that again.
If that is their goal, to gain the most muscle mass possible, then the answer is two sets, not three, not four, not five, not 12 at any stage of training, two. And the weight that they should be lifting for two sets is a weight that they can lift eight times, but not nine. And the rest period in between should be minimized to probably less than 60 seconds.
Okay, if somebody is lifting eight repetitions, that's roughly going to be about 78% of their one repetition maximum.
Yep, about right. Yep.
But you were saying that for hypertrophy, you should avoid 60 to 80%. So that's 78.
We clarified that. I said for all training involving resistance, it's all high intensity. It's all supra maximal with regard to oxygen uptake and the aerobic side of the argument that we were talking about before.
Okay.
All training is specific, and that includes resistance training, muscle training, strength training. It is all aerobic because it is all powered by oxygen ultimately. Mm-hmm. That's what the clarification was there. Mm-hmm. And then we got onto resistance training, and we did not clearly operationally define that we are now no longer talking about oxygen uptake, heart rate maximum as our marker of intensity. Now we're talking about one RM percentage, which is a completely different currency. Mm-hmm. And in strength training, resistance training, there are also correct ranges to elicit the results that you're after. And for hypertrophy, it's two sets of eight reps at any level of training. The thing that changes
we also have to take into account that if you are trying to build the most amount of muscle possible, we have to differentiate between one individual workout in a long periodized program versus the entire program itself. Because if you're trying to build the most amount of muscle possible, if you just do two sets of eight repetitions and that's all you're training all the time, you're not going to come close to your genetic potential for building muscle.
That's not so either, Stephen. I don't know where you got that idea from either.
No, it is. You need to change up the variable.
Doesn't make it so. It's not so.
I'm not just saying this. Like, this is 18 years worth of anecdotes. If you are only training in one specific repetition range at one specific intensity, if you're using the same sets, the same repetitions, same intensity, same rest periods, your body is going to have no reason to adapt and get bigger or stronger. You need to alternate between different training phases. If you were to train, like hypothetically, right? Let's say you came to me and you wanted to just build the most amount of muscle possible, and you didn't care about health, you didn't care about performance, you just wanted to be as big as humanly possible. If all I did with you was every single workout that you came to me, two sets of eight repetitions, your body's going to get used to that, and it's going to plateau.
That's why you change it up with different sorts of exercises that hit muscles in a different way. Mm-hmm. That's why you change around the way you might do any splits that you might be doing. You keep the body guessing in all sorts of different ways. That's why you might throw in drop setting. That's why you might throw in pyramid sets. That's where you might throw in super setting. That's where you might adjust your rest periods in between your sets. But you do not need to adjust the correct weight and the correct volume at any stage in your training, at any level. And the correct rep range is eight for hypertrophy, and it's two sets and not three and not four, and it's not nine reps or seven reps or 12 reps, and it's not changing it up for the sake of changing things.
There is no one. When it comes to strength, you want to train at higher intensity. You're not going to get stronger by training at low intensity. I know, but I'm going to bring this back to hypertrophy in a second. Okay. If you are training for strength, you want to train at high intensity because you're not going to get stronger training at low intensity. With regard to hypertrophy, you want to train to all.
Can you define?
You want to train at high. You want to train at moderate. You want to train at low.
You need to define high and low intensity. Operationally, what do you mean by high intensity for strength?
High intensity, 85%+. Moderate intensity, we're talking. We're going to talk 70 to 85%.
So you're talking of one RM?
Yeah.
So you're talking the difference between sets of eight and sets of four or five, basically.
So let's say 85% plus would be high intensity. That would be your one to five repetition range.
Right.
Then
more like three to five, but okay, yep.
Well, I'm saying 85 plus. So if you go to 100%, that's your one.
That's one RM. Yes. Okay.
Yeah. So I'm saying 85 plus. So 85 all the way to 100.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's your 1 to 5 repetition range.
Right.
For moderate intensity, we're talking 70 to 85. So that's going to be your 8 to 12, or that's going to be your 6 to 12 repetition range.
Well, 8.
And then, sorry?
8.
That's where that's 85. 70 to 85. 85 or 86. That's 86. Right. Yeah. So that would be eight repetitions would be roughly 83. 78% of your one repetition maximum would be 8 repetitions.
Somewhere in there. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. And then low intensity under 60, and then 60 to 70. So really you could do 60 to 85 is all moderate, or you could even break it, chunk it down even further. So you could do 70 to 85 would be your moderate intensity. And then you could do 60 to 70 would be your low moderate intensity. Anything under 60 would just be low intensity. If you are training for hypertrophy, mm-hmm. and you are always training at the same intensity, mm-hmm. you're not going to be
relative, same relative intensity. Yes.
Yeah. Relative intensity.
Yep. Sorry. Go on.
So if you're always training at the same relative intensity, you're not going to be able to accumulate the same amount of muscle as if you would alternate through the different phases. So
That is not true. False.
I'm not saying that you won't build muscle, but if, again, it's like the goal is very specific. If somebody's main objective is just to build the most amount of muscle humanly possible, they don't care about anything else. They just want to be. Regardless of whether they're taking gear or not, whether they want to do it naturally or whether they want to do it enhanced, they're not going to be able to achieve that goal of reaching their genetic potential for muscle accumulation if they always train at that same relative intensity.
Okay, I've said a number of times I don't believe that is correct. Mm-hmm. How do we move past this point? Because I still think you're wrong on that.
Here's the other thing too, with regard to saying that, so 2 sets ideal for anybody looking to build muscle. Yep. You're not taking into account the different genetics of each individual, because depending on the individual, some people are going to respond much better to higher intensity for building muscle. Some people are going to respond much better to lower intensity, and it comes down to the muscle fiber dominance. If somebody is, I know you don't believe in the fast switch, slow switch, but I'm going to use it for the purpose of this specific example. If somebody is more fast twitch dominant, they are going to respond better to higher intensity. If somebody is more slow twitch dominant, they are going to respond better to more lower intensity. And so one of the tests that I do in my clinic, particularly with my athletes, is a muscle fiber dominance test. So you take their one repetition maximum. Once you've determined their one repetition maximum, you take 85% of that number, and then you have them perform the exercise until they're no longer able to perform it anymore, depending on the repetitions that they're able to perform. So let's say somebody's one repetition maximum is 100 pounds, just to make the math easy. Mm-hmm. If somebody's one repetition maximum is 100 pounds, and then you give them 85 pounds and they can only perform 2 repetitions, mm-hmm. then that person would be much better at higher intensity for building muscle, because their body is going to respond better to those higher intensity exercises. But if you were to give somebody, let's say that same person, 100 pound is their one repetition maximum, you give them 85% and they are able to perform 10 repetitions using 85%, then their genetics and their muscle proportions are going to be better suited to more moderate and lower intensity. And they're going to be able to build muscle better on more moderate and lower intensity.
Okay, we need to go back to the earlier discussion about how muscle morphology changes as a result of training.
Well, you can change your muscle fiber dominance.
Can you point me to a single example of someone who can lift 10 times at 85% mm-hmm. of what their genuine 1RM max is? Because that's the example you just gave us. The example you just gave us is if somebody can lift 85% of their 1RM 10 times, great. Can you point me to someone that can do that?
Yeah.
Well, then you've got their 1RM wrong. You've got your 1RM measurement wrong then.
No.
Yeah, you have, because that's physiological nonsense. That's just rubbish, Stephen.
So the way that I do the assessment, if I have to put my hand on the bar, that does not count. They have to push themselves to their max. The other thing with regard to the one repetition max, the muscle fiber dominance test, is if somebody is generally more slow twitch dominant, they're not going to be able to generate the same amount of force. So they're not going to be able to...
You mean their training status is such that they're not trained for that because they've all got the same genes. They've all got the same... You know, our genes are 99.99999 something percent similar between every human being on the planet, Stephen.
Yeah, we're 99.999% similar. But if I race Usain Bolt, there's no training in the world, no amount of steroids in the world that I could take that's going to make me
beat. Sure, he's a freak. He's at one end of the bell-shaped curve. Absolutely.
Yeah. So this is what we're talking about. I'm not talking about the general population. I'm talking about these outliers. There are people, like there's... You can't say that training two sets of eight repetitions is going to be the best way to pack on muscle for every single person on the planet. You have to assess them. Some people are going to do better on high intensity. Some will do better on low. Some will do better on moderate.
Very few people are going to fall outside two standard deviations on anything, Stephen. Yes, there are going to be people who are going to be outliers on the bell-shaped curve on any assessment that you want to put together on any aspect of anything in the world. Yes, that is correct. However, to make a generalized statement about what is optimal for training for muscle hypertrophy, what I have said is the optimum is two sets of eight, where the weight is such that you can lift it eight times, but not nine. And I said that because it is correct. That is what the optimal is. And there's very little variation around that in terms of training response. That is what the literature tells us.
I'm just going based off of what I've seen in my own practice, and it's not like 90% of the people are best suited for that two sets of eight repetition. I mean, most of the people that come to me, I would say a majority of the people are going to be more of an intermediate. They're not going to, like for building muscle, they're not going to respond optimally to high intensity or low intensity. They're going to respond somewhere in the middle. And I would say probably 15% in either direction. You're going to have 15 that are going to respond better to very high intensity, 15 that will respond better to lower, and then the other maybe 70% are going to respond better to that moderate intensity. But with regard to the two sets of eight repetitions, I don't know what source you're citing, because I don't have the source in front of me, but I would seriously question that study. And I would have to look at it just because, again, like you're telling me,
not necessarily any one study. It's a synthesis of the knowledge of, I don't know how many hundred studies I've read in my more than 25 years as an exercise physiologist, first and foremost, actually, before I'm a nutritionist. Mm-hmm. And as a publishing research scientist in the field of exercise physiology, who has been there, who has done that, who has got the T-shirt, who has worked with the New Zealand All Blacks, who has worked with the Australian Army and the New Zealand Army on their fitness protocols, who has worked with a number of the UK athletes in preparation for their 2011 Olympic campaigns, who has, you know, the runs on the board here. Absolutely, we can get into a citation war if you like. That's not a war that you're going
to
win.
I'm not trying to get into a citation war. I'm just saying I don't have the studies in front of me that you are citing, so I can't, without analyzing the study, I can't say like, okay, yeah, your study is right, or no, your study is wrong. It's because you have the information, I don't. So I can't refute you, and I can't confirm you either, because I don't have it in front of me. I can't look at it and I can't analyze it and say, yeah, this stuff was wrong.
But you are refuting me, though. You are saying, no, I think you're wrong when you say that everybody...
I'm not necessarily saying you're wrong. I'm just saying in the 18 years that I've been doing this with all of the people that I've assessed, with my clientele, that two sets of eight, they're not going to achieve the maximum amount of muscle possible.
Then you've got the weight wrong.
No.
Yes.
No.
Yes, still. No amount of saying no will change the fact. If you are saying that your clients will not respond optimally to two sets of eight, then you have got the weight wrong. You have assessed the weight that they should be doing wrong.
No, I haven't assessed it wrong. I've assessed them properly.
They're not responding optimally, Stephen. If you had said it correctly, they would be responding optimally, because that is what the literature tells us. That is what my experience in more than a quarter of a century as an exercise physiologist tells me. That is what worked for me when I trained myself for muscle hypertrophy training and for muscle strength training at various different times.
Well, for me, when I got to my absolute biggest in my life, for me personally, I responded the absolute best to the around 6 repetition range for me.
Okay, what else did you change? Because there would have been other degrees of freedom that played into that result other than the amount of weight that you were lifting and the number of times that you were lifting it. Did you control absolutely everything else? No.
I controlled every single variable possible. So aside from the exercise, I'm very meticulous with my programs. I account for the sets. I account for the reps. I account for the intensity. I always use a very specific intensity. I account for tempo. Every time I work out, I work out to a metronome. So I set a specific tempo. I follow that tempo to the T. I account for the rest period. The program that I did today was a powerlifting program. My rest was 3 minutes. I had the metronome going at 180 seconds on the dot. I lifted it. I didn't go at 179. I didn't go at 181. My programming is meticulous. And for me, I respond best in that 1 to 6 repetition range.
Okay. And so at the time that you were doing all of that stuff, did you also have a genetically identical twin or a clone of yourself doing what I'm suggesting under exactly the same conditions to compare those two things?
I've trained at the 8 repetition range before and it works, but like
answer the question you were asked, because we all know what the answer is. The answer is no, you
didn't. Okay, no, I don't have an identical twin, but when you were training
establish as a fact what you are now proposing. What you're giving me is your opinion. And okay, you're entitled to your opinion. You think
you respond optimally to
a certain rep range. I accept that that's your anecdote and that's what you believe. However, when we're looking at populations at large and what is best for the population at large, we have the data on this. We have the research on this and it is absolutely clear. It's 2 sets of 8 reps.
Okay.
And the variation around that is very little.
Let me ask you a couple of questions. The first question is, have you ever coached an IFBB pro bodybuilder?
Have I coached an IFBB pro bodybuilder? No, bodybuilding has never been my thing.
Okay. Do you know any IFBB pro bodybuilders?
Yes, I do.
Okay. If you were to tell an IFBB pro bodybuilder, if you eat the dirt in the ground, you are going to build muscle, but you have to eat it at exactly 3:06 in the morning, would they do it if they thought it was going to help them build muscle?
Depends, really. I know some bodybuilders.
This hypothetical person, that's all they care about. All they want to do is build muscle. They don't care about anything else.
Right.
Would they do it if you told them that it would help them build muscle?
Again, you're asking me to guess on the psychology of a hypothetical person.
Okay, well, the reason, so I've coached some IFBB pros in the past. If they believe that something is going to help them build muscle, they will do it. They do not care what it is. I've had IFBB pros literally blend up, calamari rings. Calamari rings because they didn't like the eating them and they would literally drink it because they thought that they needed to eat it and it would help them build muscle. A lot of bodybuilders are like that. If they believe that something is going to help them build muscle, they will do it. Yep. If 2 sets of 8 repetitions is the optimal rep range for building muscle, every single IFBB pro bodybuilder would be training in that 2 set of 8 repetition range.
So now you've got an appeal to consensus authority fallacy going on there. Because everybody who's a professional cyclist trains doing miles and miles and miles and miles. Therefore, it's optimal and correct.
Yeah, but you basically just did the same thing though. You used an appeal to authority fallacy when you referenced your citations because the studies that you're referencing, I don't have them in front of me, so
the difference is not a fallacy. That's the difference. Sorry? The difference is what I just said about what the literature tells us in terms of what's optimal is not a fallacy. What I told you was correct and indicated.
What you've stated isn't correct. It's what you've stated.
That's why I said it. I don't say things that are incorrect, Stephen. I'm very, very careful about that.
The studies that you've read, there are plenty of studies that would contradict the studies that you are citing right now.
Now are you suggesting to me that the only way to establish causality, correctness, factuality is through studies?
No, what I'm saying is the studies that you are presenting, let's say hypothetically that the studies that you are citing are in fact true for the general population.
Yep.
The optimal way to build up. Sorry?
Which they are. That is why I said it.
Okay. Well, I disagree, but let's say that for argument's sake that I agreed with you that for the general population, that would be the optimal repetition range, 2 sets of 8 repetitions to build the maximum amount of muscle possible.
Yep.
Then you're whenever any type of study, it doesn't matter how perfectly the study is designed, it is intended for a general audience. Yes. And they are not going to be able to take into account the different individual variances from person to person.
Which is not very much. That's the whole point. The variation between human beings is not a great deal. In terms of their trainability, their physiology, what their body will do under the influence of correct training. And what I'm telling you, Stephen, is that almost nobody out there in the world of exercise and training and sports performance and all of that, almost nobody is training correctly. They're all doing it wrong.
I don't disagree with that part. There are a lot of people doing things wrong, but the idea that there is one specific way that every single person, or at least the general pop, when I say one specific way, I don't mean like one, it has to be 2 sets of 8. I'm just saying the idea that there is one way for the entire population to train without taking into account all of those different variables, you're not going to be able to get. Okay, here, let me put it to you this way. If most people would benefit from training in that 2 sets of 8 repetitions. Mm-hmm. Then
why don't they? Is that the question?
No, that's not the question that I was going to ask. If 2 sets of 8 repetitions is the optimal... Actually, before I even ask the question, let's just get a couple things straight first. Mm-hmm. So we mentioned already relative intensity with regard to the for training.
Yeah.
So just to clarify your position, training at 2 sets of 8 repetitions, every single time they train at 2 sets of 8 repetitions, you are operating under the assumption that they are getting stronger so that their relative intensity will go up. So hypothetically, let's say that their 8 repetition maximum is 80 pounds. Mm-hmm. You're operating under the assumption that 80 pounds will continue to increase, and that is what is going to elicit the hypertrophy response for that individual. Because if they keep the weight the same, there's going to be no growth. Am I correct so far?
The weight that is being used for 8 reps is adjusted according to what their new level of strength is. As they gain hypertrophy, they'll also be gaining some strength, and as such, their 1 RM will go up, and as such, their 8 RM will go up. At first, it goes up quite precipitously, quite steeply at the beginning of a training program, obviously. And most of that is actually neural learning rather than anything metabolic. And then there's generally a kind of knee over or a leveling off period. And then there's slow, steady gains for most people up to a point where they will then reach their, I guess, predetermined maximum and remain relatively stable there and get very, very, very little gain thereafter. That is the typical response curve on that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So with regard to your example of the two sets of eight repetitions, mm-hmm. are you, when you say that that is the best repetition and set range for people to train to build the most amount of muscle possible,
yeah.
are you talking about for 60% of the population, 70% of the population, 90% of the population? What exactly, like what percentage of the population would be best suited to train in that specific style that you're suggesting right now?
Okay, so now you're talking about the variation in what is in effect optimal for a given individual as opposed to what is optimal for the population at large. There is a standard deviation around number of reps and number of sets that is optimal in effect for different individuals. How do we know that? Because the different individuals in the different studies I'm talking about had an individual response slightly. What I'm suggesting to you is that the standard deviation around what is optimal is very, very narrow in terms of number of reps and number of sets. Very narrow.
So what percentage of the population would that style of training be best suited for or be optimal for?
Well, that question still has to be answered the same way, everybody. Sure, some individual people might have got a better response with slightly more or slightly fewer reps, and I mean one or two reps difference, not a lot, a whole bunch. And in terms of sets, number of sets, effectively, the standard deviation is less than half a set. So that means 95% of the population do best on two sets, and only 5% of the population would do better on one set or three sets.
Now, with these numbers that you were referring to, is this untrained individuals or is this...
It doesn't make any difference because it's all relative to training status. At that
so time. Whether somebody is going into the gym for the first time of their life or whether they've been training, like myself, for 23 years,
yes.
two sets of eight repetitions is going to be the ideal...
If you set the weight appropriately, yes. For most people, at any stage of training, yes.
Regardless of gender.
Correct.
See, I got to disagree with you right there.
Go ahead.
Because every again, this is a generalization, but whenever I assess people that are coming to me for performance and we end up doing, if somebody comes to me for performance, there's a structural balance assessment. One of them, it involves a one repetition maximum. Then there is an accessory lift portion just to test their scapular retractors, their external rotators, just to kind of see if their shoulder is properly stabilized in order to be able to handle the load. And then there's a muscle fiber dominance test. With men and women, generally, men will be able to perform fewer repetitions at 85% of their one repetition than a woman. A woman will be able to perform more repetitions. So if a man and a woman both have a one repetition maximum of 100 pounds, generally, let's say at 85 pounds, the man will perform less repetitions than the woman.
Yes, but so what?
So the men, they tend to respond better to higher intensity. And the women, when it comes to building muscle, they tend to respond better to lower intensity. And I know this because I've alternated.
Respond better? Define Sorry? That. What do you mean respond better? Define that.
Muscle size. They are like a man will be able to put on more muscle size.
Really? A man will be able to put on more muscle size than a woman? Fuck me. I've never heard of that before.
More relative to their potential than a woman. So let's say hypothetically a man is able to put on 10% more size on a given body part training at a high intensity. A woman, to get that same 10% response, she's not going to accomplish that training at that same high intensity. She's going to have to do more volume, meaning she's going to have to train at a lower intensity.
A woman is not going to be able to naturally put on as much muscle mass as a man at any intensity.
That's not what I'm saying. And I agree that she's not going to be able to put on as much muscle, but that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is for the man will be able to achieve more of his potential at a higher intensity. The woman will be able to achieve more of her potential at a lower intensity.
Okay, that's an opinion, and I disagree entirely.
That's not an opinion. That's 18 years worth of anecdotes.
Well, that's an opinion.
Well, I mean, I can say the same thing about you.
27, 28, 29 years of experience in weightlifting. I don't currently lift. I haven't for some time, but that doesn't change the physiology or the facts around it. So I can give you anecdotes all day as well, just as well as you can. And I disagree entirely with what you're saying. The optimum set range for hypertrophy training is 2, and the optimum weight is a weight that you could lift 8 times, but not 9. The variation around that between individuals, whether they are a man or a woman, is very, very minimal. Facts. What's next?
Okay, so we're talking about building the most amount of muscle humanly possible.
In which case you take the juice.
Yeah. Okay. Regardless of, so you have who on the juice trains at 2 sets of 8 repetitions and has achieved.
None of them, because they're all fucking insane, Stephen. They're all absolutely off their chops. They are mad. They don't give a shit about anything. And they believe that just because they can tolerate a higher volume of exercise than that, that they should. They think that's going to give them yet even more benefit because they are ill-educated. You can tell they're ill-educated because they've taken the juice, which is the most incredibly fucking stupid thing in the world that you can do.
Well, I've worked with some very uneducated IFBB pros. I'm not going to deny that they
are not an appropriate example for what we're talking about, which is the general population. Mm-hmm. So if you want to talk about putting on the most muscle mass humanly possible, naturally, mm-hmm. without steroids and without the fucking insanity, then the answer is 2 sets of 8. Period.
Who has accomplished the most amount of muscle possible naturally using that 2 sets of 8 method?
You tell me.
I don't know anybody because I don't know anybody that has achieved those types of results doing 2 sets of 8. All of the best results that I've seen, it has come from alternating through different periods. I've never seen anybody.
Have you done a study that establishes that those people would not have responded better had they done what I'm suggesting is what is shown by the literature to be what is optimal? No, you haven't done that.
You haven't done that either.
You're giving me your opinion, Stephen.
Yeah, but you're welcome to an opinion.
You are absolutely welcome to an opinion. I'm talking about what the evidence that I have read over more than 30 years tells me. I am talking about what I have applied in populations of unwell people, generally well people, sub-elite athletes, and also elite athletes. And it is the same for everybody. It's all relative, of course, in terms of weight, but in terms of resistance training, sets and reps, in terms of muscle hypertrophy, the answer is 2 sets of 8 with very little variation, very, very little.
These studies that you read with regard to the 2 sets of 8,
I've also done studies. I've been the primary investigator.
Okay,
the studies that you have conducted that
demonstrate that 2 sets of 8 repetitions is the optimal amount of stimulus for building the most amount of muscle possible. How much muscle were the participants on average able to accumulate over what period of time?
putting specific numbers on that is very difficult when I'm talking about a synthesis of a body of literature read over 30 years. If you want to get into, as I said, if you want to get into a pissing contest on bloody citations, we can do that too. But I don't think anybody would want to watch that. We can certainly send citations backwards and forwards about people that found slightly different things in different studies with slightly different methodologies, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You bet. What's the point of your question?
The point of my question is, if we could determine the amount, if you would answer what the amount of muscle that was accumulated during the two sets of eight, then I could say, yeah, you know what? That method is right, because I've done this method. This method was able to achieve X results, and your results are way better than the results that I've been able to. So at least it would give me more. It would give me more confidence in just being able to agree with you than not knowing the results.
The fundamental issue is that none of the studies that have been done on human beings in this regard are adequately powered, adequately tenured, adequately controlled, adequately observed. None of them are metabolic Ward, Lock, and Levin studies, and none of them are done with sets of genetically identical twins. So it's all about guessing or guesstimating based on the relative amounts of muscle mass that people have been able to put on under any kind of control at all, which is basically none. So as such, my professional opinion is based on a synthesis of that information, and I could give you a thesis on that and provide you with 300, 400, 500 references on which that opinion is based, but you'd have to go and read through all those 300, 400, 500 papers and form your own opinion on how you read the veracity and value of all of those different studies to come to your opinion. You're saying you disagree with what I'm saying, and I'm saying that's fantastic. You go ahead and disagree with me. Nonetheless, you're not going to change my opinion on what is optimal in terms of, should we give everybody the same starting point? Yes. And for 90-something percent of people that I ever deal with, I never have to change away from that in order to achieve great results for those people.
Let me say this then. So you just said, it doesn't matter who you train, two sets of eight repetitions, you get phenomenal results.
Yep.
Yeah. Are you familiar with German volume training?
Is correct.
Yeah. Are you familiar with German volume training?
Yes.
Okay, so before I started getting into more comprehensive assessments when I was younger, everybody did German volume training as a first-time workout. It didn't matter who it was. Mm-hmm. And every single person got great results. So just if every single person...
Because if you could achieve the same or better result, volume, wouldn't that be better?
Sorry, say that again?
If you could achieve the same or better results... whatever your metric of results is, while putting in less volume, wouldn't that be more optimal?
Well, yeah, if I could get the same results from my training routine now, training 5 minutes instead of 45 minutes to an hour, yeah, I'd love to get the same or better results in 5 minutes. But
awesome.
What I would love to be able to do and what I'm capable of currently doing are two different things. So the reason I brought up the German volume training is because you said that every person that you trained doing two sets of eight got great results.
Yep.
Every single person that I've ever done German volume training with the exception of one Asian woman, got great results doing the German volume training. But every single person, their body fat with it, this isn't just one example. I've had a few people where their body fat, they ended up shedding over 10% in 6 weeks. Mm-hmm. And they've put on a significant amount of lean mass, mm-hmm. and their strength shot up through the roof. So if your anecdotal evidence of everybody I trained on two sets of eight got great results, it's proof that two sets of eight is optimal, then I could easily just say every single person that I've done 10 sets of 10 using 60% intensity with a minute 40 seconds rest in between, they all got phenomenal results too. So therefore, that is the optimal result.
Right, problem with that, Stephen, is if I could get with my clients who are nominally somehow controlled to be remotely a similar population to your clients for their best approximation of a research twins pair design that we could possibly do, and I could get the same or better results that you get with a quarter of the training volume, then who's optimal, me or you?
If you could get the same results, then yeah, of course yours would be optimal.
Right, well, that's what I'm telling you.
But here, okay, you're asking a hypothetical question of, if my program requires less effort and gets better results, is my program better? Obviously, the answer is yes. Right. But if my program gets better results than your program, then my program's better. So it's a moot point. It's a moot question to ask, because you're asking a hypothetical, and the hypothetical that you're asking is assuming that your program is going to achieve better results than the program that I'm suggesting. In order for us to really see which program would be the best, like, again, we would need to have, like, quintuplets, have five different programs, yeah, have every single one of them doing one of the five different programs, and then, yeah, see, okay, this person did 2 sets of 8, this, yeah, person did 10 sets of 10, yeah, this person did the 6-12-25 method, this person did the 1-6 method, this person, yeah, did that.
Yeah.
But all of the studies that, everything that you're saying that relates to the 2 sets of 8, I could counter you with the same criticisms that you're offering me, because none of the studies, I'm assuming, I haven't read the studies, but none of the studies that you're suggesting would have compared the 2 sets of 8 with a different type of training program to see which one is optimal. Like, I could put 100 people through 2 sets of 8 and yeah, they'll get good results, yeah, but I don't know that those results are going to be better than if they did 10 sets of 10, if they did 5 sets of 5, 3 sets of 3.
Right. So the best we've got is to use the most nominally similar research populations that are available to us in the broad range of literature available in the pseudoscience that's out there, and look at the end of the day at the results that people have gained. So if our output metric is hypertrophy, mm-hmm, then we need studies that looked specifically at the gain of muscle tissue specifically, mm-hmm, over a period of training with anything like reasonable, decent controls. And if you've got, for example, which you will get because humans are quite similar, if you get two populations of people who nominally, one did a relatively low intensity, relatively high volume resistance training program, and one who did the inverse, a relatively high intensity, very low volume resistance training program. And let's say both those populations got a similar result in terms of muscle mass gained specifically, which is what you will find. Which one of those is the optimal of those two training programs? It's the, well,
obviously,
one with the lower volume. Right.
Yeah, obviously,
that's my argument. That's why I'm, yeah, saying 2 sets of 8 is optimal, because 2 sets of 8 gets the job done for everybody.
But you,
pretty much.
You say that 2 sets of 8 gets the job done for everybody, but you haven't been able to reference one single person that has achieved the type of results you're suggesting performing 2 sets of 8 repetitions exclusively.
Well, I'm one. I achieved optimal results for myself when I was weight training many years ago. I have many people I've worked with and coached who I could point
to.
Absolutely.
How do you know that your results were optimal? How do you know that you wouldn't have gotten better results on 3 sets of 9 or 1 set of 6 or 5 sets of 2? How do you know?
Because the only gauge we've got on this available to us leads me to the educated belief that that is so, because the actual results that human beings actually get in terms of muscle mass gain as a result of training programs in the literature are all remarkably similar, actually. There is very little difference in most studies in terms of what the outcome metric is, muscle mass gained specifically. Ergo, the most efficient way of doing it is apparently the optimal program. So that is what I espouse. There is no need to do 3 sets. 2 will get the job done, so long as you keep your intensity where it should be. There is no need to spend hours in the gym when you can spend minutes in the gym.
My workouts are 20 minutes to an hour long.
Awesome. But are you doing a whole body split? Or are you doing different splits?
My current routine is it's a 7-day split, but it's a little bit weird. So I'll have a max push day on Monday. Tuesday is my max squat day. Wednesday is a max max chin up day. Thursday is a max deadlift day. Friday, I'll do speed pushing. Saturday, I'll do speed squat and deadlifts. And then Sunday, I'll do speed.
If you came to me, I would set your training program up entirely differently, Stephen. I really would.
How would you set up my program?
I would have you in the gym no more than 3 to 4 times a week. And I'd have you.
Here's the thing. Let me preface the reason I train every single day. It's not because I want to get the best results possible. For me, I enjoy training. So I train every day and I split it up that way just because I enjoy training every day. So if you were to write me a program.
Insanity. Okay, good.
Just for me, like mentally, it helps me to train every single day. If you were to write me a program 3 to 4 days a week, I wouldn't like it just because I would want to do something on those other 3 to 4 days. And I never do cardio because I hate doing cardio. So the only other option is to do weights. That's why I train seven days a week.
You are probably, and you look in great shape and I've seen the pictures and your physique looks fantastic. I'm not saying otherwise, but I would suggest that you are probably costing yourself quite a bit in terms of what you could achieve if you actually trained appropriately. And training every day is inappropriate without question. You should not be doing that.
It depends on how exactly you're structuring your program. Because right now I'm training every single day, but by the time I train the same movement pattern, I've fully recovered and I'm capable of performing optimally without having the previous work.
I get that because you described your split. So I get that that's what you're doing.
Yeah.
However, nonetheless, my statement was very clear and explicit. And I said, you should not be training every day. Full stop. Period. Because you should.
Oh, I know. Like if I want to maximize results, I know I shouldn't be training every day. I was just saying what I currently do just because that's my training. I'm not trying to build the most amount of muscle humanly possible. That's not my goal.
In which case you would be taking the gear. We've covered this.
Yeah. Yeah. Like actually here, since we're talking about optimal training, for me personally, the best results I ever got was training 3 out of every 5 days. That was the best I ever got. So
there you
the
go.
Way that yeah.
Right.
So I would do 2 days of training, take a break, a day of training, take a break, and then I would repeat the cycle.
Mm-hmm.
So it wasn't a consistent schedule like every Monday, Wednesday, Friday. So my Monday workout would be my Saturday workout, would be my Thursday workout.
Yeah.
But yeah, the best results I ever got in my life were on a 5-day split. It was 2 days on, 1 day off, 1 day on, 1 day off, and then I repeated the cycle.
Okay.
And I would repeat the cycle for 6 workouts. After 6, I find that for me, 6 to 7 workouts, I plateau. If I do the same workout for more than 6 or 7 workouts, my everything plateaus. I don't get any stronger. I'm not trying to build muscle, but if I were to try and build muscle, it wouldn't really help after 6 to 7 workouts. For me, that's what I found to be optimal for me. 3 out of every 5 days.
Awesome. All right. Yeah. I think it's probably about time to close off. It's been over 2 hours. It's been fascinating, Stephen. I've enjoyed it. It's been challenging. It's been fun. There are many, many things you and I agree on, absolutely, clearly, and many things that we have a different experience to one another on, and that's fine. That's what makes the world go round. I really appreciate the fact that you've actually fronted up, because basically almost nobody in the health and fitness space has the balls to actually front up to me and to have a discussion with me on any aspect of science. They're all afraid to do it. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's unfortunate, because it's a lost opportunity for the learning of everybody, including myself. I learn something every time I engage in a discussion with someone. I never walk away with it thinking, well, that was a waste of time. So, I want to thank you for that. People, if you want to find Stephen, it's Team Euphoric, basically everywhere you look. If you do a Google search on that, you can't, or for balance, there are other search engines available. Put in Team Euphoric and you'll find Stephen. And if you want to get more of the good juice on his ideas on training and fitness and diet and everything else, that's where you find him. Where do you find me? Well, you guys have already found me, so you know I'm here. Also, I have a number of other YouTube channels. Make sure you're subscribed to all of them. And also, if you wanted to take an odyssey of discovery out there, that odyssey might lead you finding me on another platform somewhere as well, where I still do the kind of videos I used to do on this platform that I can't do here anymore because they don't like it. People's fifis are very important. We can't go around hurting people's feelings and talking about their appearance and stuff. Apparently that's not okay. All right. So, Stephen, you're the guest. You can close us off.
All right. Well, yeah, it was great talking to you. And likewise, I enjoy having discussions. Even if I disagree 90% with somebody that I'm talking to, that 10%, I learn 10% more. So even if I disagree with somebody on almost everything, just being able to learn. Actually, here, I'm going to end on this. So one of my things, I'm always trying to continue my education. So I make it a mission to do at least 5 courses a year. And there was one course, learned absolutely nothing except for one piece of information. And because I learned that one thing over the course of 5 days, I thought it was worth it. So I'm not saying that I disagree with you on everything except for one topic. We agree on quite a bit, but I have learned a little bit. So it was definitely worth the conversation, and I enjoyed it. And yeah, even if I only learned one thing, it was worth it just for that.
All right. Thanks again. Thank you all for being here and sitting through it. Thank you for your participation in the chat. Thank you for those several of you that super chatted. That's very much appreciated. That's what keeps the lights on. This is my job, by the way. I don't have another job anymore. So appreciate that very much. And I do appreciate your time, Stephen, and your the courage of your convictions to front up and say, this is how I feel about things. Good on you. All right. Thanks all. See you next time.